gone surfing. We all know what it means, don't we? Two simple words that say it all. The motto of a surfer's escape. Well, over this past year, we've gone surfing a lot and heard a few surf stories along the way. Stories we'd like to share with you. I guess it really started when we arrived early for our annual trip to the North Shore and found things there already going full tilt. What a scene. A perfect example of how crazy things can get when our whole world has gone surfing in exactly the same place. For some reason, there was a lot of girls around this year, and we heard some amazing stories about all that. But those aren't for this film. Nothing wrong with looking, though. Just ask Vince Klein. Let's face it, the North Shore is all about serious surfing, and the boys were getting down to business as usual. And for the top names in the sport, more often than not, that business is all about getting the shot. This time of year, the North Shore is like some giant photo studio, a time when reputations can be made or lost on every wave that rolls in. Yeah, the price of fame can be pretty scary. Still, everyone seems to take all this action in pretty good stride. Well, almost everyone. But it's always the best who excel. Now with the speed these guys reach and the insanely crowded conditions, crashes are inevitable. This guy finally found a wave all to himself and wished he hadn't. And he wasn't the only one. As usual, the locals were ripping this year. Here's Junior with a few heavy moves all his own. The 7-mile stretch of sand has given our sport a number of great surfers. Surfers like Hans Hiedemann, who among others has spent years at the top ranks of pro surfing. Year after year, Hawaii seems to produce some of the world's best, and this year, the obvious heir apparent and new pipeline master was Derek Ho, a Hawaiian surfer with a big future who had a chance to talk to us on what it's all about.
You know what it all comes down to is yourself and the ocean and the competitor you're surfing against, and you just have to go out there and do the best you can. Yeah, I'm very proud to be a Hawaiian representing Hawaii, and I feel I'm in my prime right now, and you know, I think it's time to get serious.
Here's Derek getting serious. Now it's pretty obvious that great surfing is part of the heritage of the Ho family. Derek was lucky enough to grow up surfing, inspired by one of the greatest Hawaiian surfers ever, his brother Michael.
My brother was a very big influence in my surfing. Since I was a little kid, I'd always look up to him, and he taught me a lot of things about surfing, and I kind of just took it from there and into my own hands.
Star is high, only one thing, it's all a lie.
watching his surfing this year, we were convinced that great things lay ahead for Derek Ho. Now, when you're on the North Shore, it's impossible not to feel the presence of Dane Kealoha. Without a doubt, Dane has been the greatest Hawaiian surfer of the modern age. His guts for glory style captured the world's imagination and still serves to inspire the island's younger generation. Since Dane's retirement from the pro circuit, he's been able to spend more time at home, ripping the South Shore by summer and the North Shore in winter. Believe me, Dane's still hitting it hard, taking each wave he catches to the limit. No doubt about it, in the islands, Dane Kealoha is still the man. Dane has more time for family, too, and on the anniversary of his daughter's birth, he invited us to her traditional Hawaiian luau.
From when I was a young kid, everything to do with my family was the base of Hawaiian heritage. I've learned and heard about Hawaiian music. I've, you know, learned about Hawaiian language, and I've learned about Hawaiian people themselves feeling from their heart deep down inside and showing the aloha. And I hope someday that the whole world could feel like this, and I hope the whole world could just live together as one, doesn't matter what race, what color, and what country you come from. Still that image about professional surfing in Hawaii, it has to clean up. And I think this next generation that's coming around will probably do it. They get very aggro, but they're not violent like the generation I was brought up in. Sooner or later, we're gonna have a Hawaiian world champion. And I think it's gonna come from this generation, this new wave of kids that are coming from Hawaii.
It seems a lot of Hawaiian surfers this year felt the pull to explore their own unique Polynesian heritage, retracing their roots to those other islands in the deep South Pacific. One of these modern Hawaiian explorers was Marvin Foster, who told us about his search that led to some very personal discoveries. Once in Tahiti, Marvin found it hard to identify with the reenactments of the ancient traditions performed for the benefit of tourists. And it wasn't until he actually hit the water that he began to feel the blood tie he has with the ancestral home of surfing. Marvin told us about one session in particular that was magic. It was just him and his hot local friend, Arsene Haraho, out all alone on some obscure reef, sharing waves just as their ancestors had once done, surfing for the pure love of it.
Come on.
After this experience, Marvin knew he'd found what he came looking for. Perfect waves, a beautiful land, and another spiritual thread in the tapestry that connects him with the brotherhood of his past. Now, while we're on the subject of the origins of surfing, this year we thought we'd take a look at body surfing and try and catch up on what's happening with the true original form of our sport. The levels of performance have certainly changed, but the attitude that it takes to swim out into the surf with just a pair of fins is still the same. Let's face it, these guys are crazy.
Your love's got me spinning around in a whirlpool. It's got me slipping and sliding, running and hiding like a dumb fool. I'll meet you at the station at a half.
I mean, really, as if this guy ever stood a chance. But it must feel great, because it's always been around, and it looks like it's going to stay that way. Check this guy, getting the longest tube we've ever seen without a board. Figure out what this guy was doing.
Here we go again. Here we go again. Go.
Body surfing is the purest, simplest form of our sport. We were stoked to see that the spirit of it is still about swimming out into the ocean and having some fun. Now, another tradition for visiting surfers has always been that of trying to buy some wheels to get them out to the North Shore. Like most of us, Californians Chewy Reyna and Chris Frohoff didn't have a whole lot of bread to spend, so needless to say, their ride wasn't going to be the best on the lot. But that never changes the sales pitch. It always starts with the handshake, then moves to the car's finer points. Appearances notwithstanding, it always looks good to the salesman. Some surfers are still unconvinced, so if the soft sell doesn't work, then comes the hard sell. At this point, they know they've got you, and a surfer and his money are soon parted. Of course, you get much more than just the car. You get the traditional North Shore guarantee, and we all know what that's worth. There was another side to the Hawaiian story this winter, and we were lucky enough to catch Pipeline in a different light. When the conditions are just right, the North Shore's most dangerous spot can take on a deceivingly beautiful look, especially when being surfed by a master like Jerry Lopez, sessioning here with a couple of friends on one of the best days of the year. Thank you. one of the most amazing surf stories in Hawaii this year was about sailboarding. We'd flown over to Maui to check out the scene and were lucky enough to capture Hukipa on the biggest day ever ridden. Trying desperately to get outside, Greg Aguera's first attempt met disaster. Rich Myers was the first to ride, and the beach was stunned at the scale of things. These masts are 16 feet high. Malta Simmer here, with a bottom turn to oblivion. Then it was Robbie Nash, racing out and catching some of the heaviest air ever seen. By now, this all-time session was well underway. Conditions mellowed a bit, the session changed from one of survival to one of high performance. Best windsurfers in the world out, it wasn't long before the limits were being pushed by sailors like Alan Cadez. Then all of a sudden, Australia's David Shire upped the ante with one of the most insane moves ever seen. After that, the action reached a fever pitch as the crew pulled out the stops and took to the air. Mark Arguella was the first to show that the Hawaiians were still on top of things. Klaus Zimmer paying some dues, caught inside on a bummer in the Hukipa rocks. But outside, the crew was still going for it. You have the spirit of going for it. That's what Hawaiian surfing is all about. Now you ask anyone who's gone surfing in Baja about the trip and you'll find that they've always an amazing surf story to tell. Take for instance our trip back in July with John McClure and Richard Schmidt. Things started out innocently enough. We'd had lunch and after picking up some of the essentials for the long drive south, we were stoked to be on the road again, eagerly anticipating the great surf ahead. You have to remember to be careful on these narrow 1.5 lane Baja freeways. You never know what the truck drivers down here have been drinking. Before long, our crew was off-road, chasing down a hot tip out in the middle of nowhere. At the last little town before the coast, the locals assured us that the Olas Grandes were just up ahead. Look that big to us, so Richard went fishing for dinner instead. John went too, but all he caught was dessert. Now the next morning, the surf had come up a bit, so John rushed through his idea of a Mexican instant breakfast. this wasn't the most perfect surf in the world, but it was empty. And after a few days on the road, it felt awfully good to us. Surf was all right. But still, we knew that there was some perfect surf out there somewhere, so we set out in search once again. But we'd forgotten that the Baja Desert always takes a heavy toll. And before long, two of our three trucks were dead in their tracks. Well, the boys still remained enthusiastic about Baja, and Richard suggested it was high time we rented an airplane anyway. So we did, and we're soon off again on a wing and a prayer. We'd heard about an offshore island that always had great surf, and by this time, having eaten our share of hot, dusty miles, we were really ready for some great waves. But by the time we got there, it was dead flat. This was just too much for anyone to take, and the boys finally cracked and were soon busy drowning their Baja sorrows. So after 3 weeks on the road, untold hassle and still no real surf, all that was left for us to do was to head home from another Baja disaster. Now back home, it was just as flat and miserable, and it was a cold and dejected John McClure who sat on the beach wondering how to get the surf to come up. John only had one more idea left, so he crossed his fingers and gave it a try.
Welcome to Surfline Surf Forecast, 976 Surf. Today, a fading southwest groundswell resulted in more small and gutless surf in Southern California. Our old groundswell will continue to diminish tonight, so tomorrow will be yet another day of poor surf. If you don't mind traveling to Southern Baja or Mexico, however, you should get the full effects of a major south swell that was generated by a large and intense storm system that developed late last week off of eastern New Zealand. Unfortunately for California, the brunt of the swell was blocked out by the Society Islands, so you'd better head south if you're looking for waves. Thanks for calling Surfline 976 Surf.
We couldn't believe it when we heard at this, John and Richard had turned around and headed straight back to deep Baja. But I guess that's what it takes to get Baja perfect. In the desert, surfing is either heaven or hell. There is no middle ground. Down here, 1,000 miles from home, Richard and John had finally scored. Despite all the hassles, this would be one surf story Richard and John would always remember. David Eggers, Matt Archibald, Brad Gerlach. Radical, explosive, outrageous. Members of the next generation. To hear their story is to hear the future. This next generation surfs like every wave is their last. Behind every maneuver is the best they've got. With such radical attitudes, who knows what the future holds in store. About some pretty good surf he'd found down in Puerto Rico, and how he and David Eggers had hit it just right. Even when things were looking bad, it always turned out for the better. In this case, it was a timely rescue by Jesse Fernandez, who was already on his way to one of his favorite spots. Soon, Brad, Dave, and Jesse had joined forces and launched the assault. Lucky for Brad and Dave that they'd run into Jesse, or they never would have caught this day. The surf had just come up, and the word wasn't out yet, so they had the next few hours all to themselves.
She's on her own now.
revealed even better surf. Brad and David were pretty stoked. And they weren't the only ones. This trip turned out all right for Brad and Dave. And as they turned and watched Jesse ride the last wave of the day, they were stoked that they had taken this time away from the pro circuit to discover another side of surfing. Now, the mainland has got some surf stories of its own, so we decided to take a little road trip from coast to coast. We started by calling up Anthony Rufo in Santa Cruz, and he told us the surf was pumping. We arrived just in time to see him take this shortcut to the surf. Yeah, his girlfriend was real impressed. This day, the lane was perfect for Anthony. The lefts coming off the middle peak were winding all the way to the cliff, and he didn't waste any time putting the hammer down. Pretty big. Sometimes a surfer just has to keep his girlfriend waiting, especially when the surf is just getting better and better. Further south, we caught up with another young Californian, Peter King, who was getting ready to hit the same swell at his local break in La Jolla. We joined him and the crew for another session. Out, proving why they once called him the king of this place. Mm-hmm. Dale Dobson soul arching on his new longboard and proving that longboarders can still get two. Tide dropped, things started to get pretty brutal out there, and it was getting time for the kneeboarders to take over anyway. This guy paddled out, lucked into the wave of the day, and then wished he'd never been bored. Local kneeboarders have got this wave completely wired. Now for a change of pace on our way to the East Coast, we joined up with Dave Weaver, who'd invited his friends Dane K. Aloha and Ricky Schaefer to go snowboarding at Telluride, Colorado. Dane was really stoked. It was only the second time in his life he'd even seen snow, and he was looking forward to trying this brand new way of riding mountains. Now this was Dane and Rick's first time snowboarding, but their confidence was pretty high. Here's Rick's first attempt. Dane thought that was pretty funny. And here's Dane's first attempt. We all got a kick out of that. On the Bunny Hill, the boys' snowboarding lessons were progressing nicely. But little did they know that two runs over, the best in the world were hard at work. Trees all by himself was Dave Weaver, right in the middle of a snowboarding soul session. Dave ran into a few obstacles along the way. This time, Dane had had enough of the Bunny Hill and wanted to try some of the big stuff. It looked easy enough to him from the lip. So here's Dane K. Aloha, charging on his first run on the big hill at Telluride. Rick was game two and wasn't far behind. For the rest of the day, the ice was broken. By the time we left these guys, they were still ripping it up. Pressing on, it wasn't long before we finally arrived on the East Coast. Now, I'm sure that Maine isn't everybody's idea of a perfect spot for surf, and I must admit, the snow on the ground did make us wonder if we were in the right place. But after we'd looked up our friend Peter Pan, he assured us that the surf was happening. The air, 28 degrees. The water, 37. And the beach, frozen solid. One thing's for sure, you never have to worry about crowds at a spot like this. I remember watching these guys and thinking about how powerful the love of surfing can be. These two are out there laughing and sharing waves in conditions that couldn't be further from what the ancient Polynesians had in mind. It didn't matter, though. It was the same spirit, just different worlds. And speaking of different worlds, we had quite a culture shock when we arrived in Florida and found the vacation season in full swing. Our luck was holding, too. Just off the coast was a large storm that was promising to bring the surf up by the next day. So we hit it early with Clyde Rogers, Johnny Futch, and Rich Rudolph. And what came down was a session that had the whole East Coast buzzing for days. Guys were having a blast, but it was about time for us to be getting back to California. Our road trip was coming to an end. Now, street skating is really happening, and Nautis is the best around.
Why? How to see the world the way they want it to be? Why? Honey, go and let me live a life of peace. Why? They all disappear because all they ever do is tease. Leave me all alone, why don't y'all leave me all alone? Leave me on my own, why don't y'all leave me on my own? Don't want you on too messy, don't want you on fair rules. Just wanna live like myself, not with a bunch of fools. Why? In the need, knowing where I want to go. Why? I need a visa, I'd really love to know. Why? People wearing masks when they go out on the streets. Why? No one realizes just what I really need. Leave me all alone, why don't y'all leave me all alone? Leave me on my own, why don't y'all leave me on my own? Don't want you on your mercy, I don't want you on fair rules. Wanna live my life, my family, not with a bunch of fools. Why? Tell me what to wear, fashion changes every day. Why? Wanna cut my hair when everybody looks the same. Why?
Guys like Nautis are the new urban gorillas, constantly in search of skatable terrain the same way a surfer looks for perfect waves. But with street skating, the only thing they have to worry about is rain. Any street in the world can be hot and glassy any time of day.
Leave me on my own. On their rules. I wanna live my life myself, not with a bunch of fools. Why? Call me jerk, cause I don't drink no alcohol. Why? Shake the heads and love, cause I don't eat no animal. Why? Try to argue when it's plain to see that life would be easy if they only let me be. Leave me on my own, why don't you leave me on my own? Leave me all alone, why don't you leave me all alone? Too messy, I don't want your unfair rules. Just wanna live like myself, not with a bunch of fools. Why?
Taken on, and three of the sport's best are Christian Hosoi, Rob Roskopf, and Germany's Klaus Grobke. Skating here at Raging Waters in San Jose, the boys were testing out the new skate ramp and soon began pushing the outer limits of aerial performance.
Tell me by my smell that it's fade, and my behavior, tell me by my smell. Just cause I'm far away from home, you say I don't belong to you. You want me to shine on my culture, all the things that I've learned. You want the total adaption, the pride that I am. But what remains of the question I'd like to ask you, as soon as I fit in, who are you gonna bring the bad things to?
Heaviest move of them all, the 540-degree McTwist. Rob thought that looked pretty cool and thought he'd give it a try.
The same way as you, just cause I'm far away from home. You say I don't belong to you. You want me to shine on my culture, the things that I've learned. You want the total adaption, the pride that I earned.
Yeah, every time these guys go all out, they push the boundaries of skating a little higher. Now, this past year, we've gone surfing a lot with Richard Schmidt. Richard is a very different kind of professional surfer. His home in Santa Cruz has been the perfect place for him to establish himself as California's premier big wave rider and still enjoy a natural environment that allows him a personal relationship with the sea. Richard represents the persona of the other side of surfing that exists so far away from the contest scene.
Planning my life around the ocean cycles and living day to day is the only way for me. I've always understood living that lifestyle isn't going to make me rich, but being rich and working 9 to 5 isn't really what's happening for me. I could never see myself being a corporate surfer, surfing contests in 2-foot mush, so I just started pursuing my big wave capabilities, and it's turned out I can actually make a viable living out of it. Surfing big waves every year, testing new equipment, it's a lot of fun, and I really enjoy doing it, and so I'm pretty grateful for that.
Breaking a board would usually end a session, but for an all-round waterman like Richard, there's always alternative ways to enjoy the ocean.
I've gotten into windsurfing the last couple of years. What inspired me at first was just learning something new, but I didn't really realize the full potential until I actually started riding waves. Because I actually spent a lot more time surfing waves on my windsurfer, I found that it's really improved my surfing because I spend more time standing on the board. I get more strength in my legs, my timing becomes a lot better. So it makes it really exciting.
Even when the surf's flat, you'll always find Richard close to the sea, whether diving for abalone or working as a lifeguard for the city. And this has put him in touch with surfers on yet another level.
I've been teaching surfing classes for the last 8 summers. It's really gratifying to see someone stand up for their first time. Seeing their stoke reminds me of why I started surfing in the first place.
Recently, Richard dropped by Zoom on his way south and lucked into a pretty good winter day. But what he was really after was the more powerful island surf that lies off our coast. And 2 hours later, after hitching a ride on a fishing boat, Richard knew that he had found it. Here in the islands, Richard had found the kind of unspoiled environment that is fast disappearing along the Southern California coast, reminding us how our lives as surfers are so dependent on these fragile ocean waters. Maybe it's time we take another look at these coastal surroundings that are so important to us and realize that the protection of this environment is up to you and me. Like I said, it's always tough to get Richard away from the ocean. But one day in Hawaii, the surf was flat, and his friend Craig had talked him into playing a round of golf. Now, Craig knew the finer points of golf and started with this shortcut on his way to the course. Now, Craig's a good sport and decided to help Richard find his ball. Richard ended up with a little egg on his face, but Craig assured him that that was all part of the game. Now, Richard figured he'd show Craig how to really play this game. But he didn't realize just how far that little ball could go. Now, accidents are bound to happen, and, well, Richard was truly sorry about all this, but it wasn't such a bad lie, so he figured he might as well play on through.
after slicing his way from sand trap to sand trap, Richard did have more points than anyone else, but he was beginning to feel the strain. After this, Richard had had enough of this sport. Decided to get back to the ocean where he belonged, seeking safety in the huge Hawaiian surf. Surfing performances like this that has earned Richard a reputation for guts and a respect from the local community in the North Shore. Richard spends 4 months here every winter charging the biggest surf he can find, and somehow has lived to tell the tale.
Scared when I paddle out in Big Surf. I think anybody in their right mind has to be a little scared. No matter how good you are, you may get caught in the wrong place at the wrong time and just be in a bad situation. If you have confidence in your ability and your equipment, fear is something you could deal with a lot easier. A lot of the guys that are really committed to riding Big Surf go out there with the attitude that if their number comes up and they do really get hurt, they'd rather be out there than getting squashed in the highway. don't want to downplay the dangers of riding Big Sur, but the risk does make it more exciting. But sometimes you do have to flow with the punches.
The island. Sometimes a surfer has a trip so perfect that it becomes a story he'll tell for the rest of his life. One such surf trip was a Fijian adventure that Dane and John Dom took at the end of the summer. They'd heard about this spot from Jerry Lopez a while back and were really looking forward to what they might find. Once on the island, they found a surfing paradise. And while the surf looked awfully small to them, the fishermen said that they were sure to find surf the next morning. Now, Dane and John thought the locals were imagining things, but there was just no arguing with these guys. So that next morning, they set out with the fishermen, who said they'd take them to a perfect wave on some outer reef. The boys were still skeptical about all this, but when they arrived, they couldn't believe their eyes. Dane's first ride proved that this perfect wave was no mirage. One of the world's best waves and surf it with just a few friends is a dream all surfers share. And for all the wishful thinking, it doesn't happen very often. But for John and Dane, this dream had come true.
We'll remember this in times and places.
Dane was just in time to see his friend Aaron pull into an impossible barrel. Aaron was pretty stoked about this. Who wouldn't be? It was is a fitting end to an incredible first day in paradise for John and Dane. Early the next day, John woke up to find one of the locals just having some fun with the biggest sea snake he'd ever seen. And everybody was pretty impressed when John tried it himself. Knowing now that there were sea snakes on one side of the island, John and Dane decided to try their luck on the other side and found a fun right-hander peeling along another pass in the reef. A wave like this may not be what a surfer ultimately travels for, but when you got it all to yourselves, it sure is a lot of fun. At the end of the second day, Dane and John had slipped comfortably into the island life and had left the madness of the 20th century far behind. Awakening one morning to a tropical rain and no waves, the boys took another tip from the fishermen and were soon out on the reef again, catching even more than they'd bargained for. Dane and John were really stoked, and they brought back enough fish to feed everyone on the island. This, of course, was cause for much celebration in the village, and the chief soon set about preparing the ceremonial drink made from the kava root. Besides celebrating their great day of fishing, the locals told them that this was also the traditional way of bringing their island great luck, and they assured John and Dane that for them, this would mean a new swell. Now, the boys had been warned about this kava, so they decided to sit back and watch what happened to the first local to drink it before trying it themselves. Mmm, looked real good. Fishermen were right again. The kava had done its magic. The islanders said they hadn't seen the waves this good in years. And after watching this, Dane and John paddled out into the perfect surf for the time of their lives.
Come on!
Dane K. Aloha and John Dom are just two of us who are lucky enough to have gone surfing and found waves that they would never forget. Another surfing adventure that they would be able to look back on as one of the best times of their lives. And after all, isn't having the time of our lives what surfing is all about in the first place? On behalf of Surfer Magazine and Scott Dittrich, thanks for joining us. I'm Matt George, and we'll be on the road till next time. So until then, we'll see you in the water.